Are we going to call them? How's this going to happen? We're about to FaceTime instead of Skype. We're about to FaceTime with the Adairs over in Zambia. And we appreciate Jason working so hard to get everything set up and making it work the way it needed to. And this is the new television from the youth room. They haven't even had a chance to use it up there yet. And they were gracious enough to loan it to us. So let's go. Now, are you going to talk to them?
Yeah.
Ask them, you know, to kind of lead the discussion.
Hello.
Hey. You all right? Hey, everybody.
All right. Hey, everybody. Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas to all and all a good day. Because you give, we get to in Zambia, and everything that we do here is supported by the churches that give to in Christmas. We have programs right now. We already know what we're doing, but we have this scholarship program, and we've got the Eternity Project, and all kinds of studies. Can you hear us?
Hello. Is
there any? Okay. I was saying that we have so many programs, Bible studies, and community outreach programs we're able to do this time of year. And we are thankful. Thank you. Giving to and living to
Can you hear me? Okay. Well, I'm going to tell you about the scholarship fund for the Yeah, so we're still receiving applications because they start the school year the 1st of January. It's different from America. So getting the applications in now, and we'll be getting, we have scheduled 28th of December when we're down, and we'll give out the scholarship for this next year. So far we've got 20 applications, but we'll be receiving a lot more as we get closer. So, and the kids from last year are thankful, and they made a huge difference in their life. Several people have to go to school that otherwise not be able to go. So it's a blessing for them, and so we'll keep you on this year, on those who receive the scholarship.
What he said was there's enough money for 28 children to get scholarship money, and they're taking applications now, and they've selected 20. There's a selection process that the elders of the church and James conducts in order to make sure the money goes to kids that will focus on school and make good use of that money. So they've had the application process, which is still ongoing. They've selected 20 out of the 28, and school starts in January. And he was expressing from them, thanks to us, that because of their scholarship, they'll be able to continue their high school education there in the schools at Caputa.
Interpretation. We're just thankful for the support, thank you for the prayer.
Yes, thank you.
Merry Christmas. And that was thank you for your support and your prayers.
John said to the crowd coming out to be baptized by him, "You brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the coming wrath? Produce fruit in keeping with repentance, and do not begin to say to yourselves, 'We have Abraham as our father,' for I tell you that out of these stones God can raise up children for Abraham. The axe is already at the root of the trees, and every tree that does not produce good fruit will be cut down and thrown into the fire." "What should we do then?" the crowd asked. John answered, "Anyone who has two shirts should share with the one who has none, and anyone who has food should do the same." Even tax collectors came to be baptized. "Teacher," they asked, "what should we do?" "Don't collect any more than you are required to," he told them. Then some soldiers asked him, "And what should we do?" He replied, "Don't extort money and don't accuse people falsely. Be content with your pay." The people were waiting expectantly and were all wondering in their hearts if John might possibly be the Messiah. John answered them all, "I will baptize you with water, But one who is more powerful than I will come, the straps of whose sandals I am not worthy to untie. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire, his winnowing fork in his hand to clear the threshing floor and to gather the wheat into his barn. But he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire. And with many other words, John exhorted the people and proclaimed the good news to them. But when John rebuked Herod, the tetrarch, because of his marriage to Herodias, his brother's wife, and all the other evil things he had done, Herod added to this to them all. He locked John up in prison. When all the people were being baptized, Jesus was baptized too. And as he was praying, heaven was opened, and the Holy Spirit descended on him in bodily form like a dove, and a voice came from heaven, "You are my son, whom I love, and with you I am well pleased."
We got some in the choir. Y'all just stay.
Good morning. Ooh, y'all look so bright and happy this morning and smiling faces. I love it. So I have a question for you. Can you tell me what joy means? Anybody have any idea? What are things that make you joyful? Having Christmas? Joy that Jesus will be with us forever. Okay. All right. Do you ever get in trouble at home? Do you ever have to sit for a time out? You don't ever have to sit for a time? I know some children that have to go to time out. Austin. Okay. Well, what happens when you go to time out? You go to your room, maybe, or you have to sit for a little while on the couch and you have to be quiet. What happens after you're there for a little while and you don't have any toys, video games, nothing? You can't talk to your brother or your sister. What happens? Austin said he gets bored. Okay, do you start thinking about what you did a little bit, and maybe you tell mom and dad that, you know, you're tired of sitting in there all by yourself, and you tell mom and dad you're sorry, and you ask them to forgive you and ask them if you can come out of your room? Well, you know, a long time ago, some people in a faraway land, God's people, did the very same thing. They started worshiping idols. Do you know what an idol is? Like a statue. Okay, they started worshiping idols and things and forgot to worship God. And so God sent somebody, a man named Zephaniah, to them. And he told them that for 70, well, he tried to tell them the right things to do and they wouldn't listen. So he gave them God's message that he was going to send them away for 70 years, which is kind of, that's a big time out. And then at the end of 70 years, God would be there waiting for them to come back. And so he was. They were exiled. They were sent out of their land. And all the things they had known were taken away. They had forgotten who their true God was. They had started worshiping other things. So after 70 years and they came back, they were happy to see God again and have him back in their hearts. They had forgotten that God was in control. But at the end of the 70 years, he sent them back to their home. Do you think they were happy? Okay. Do you think God wants us to be joyful? Yes. And he rejoices when we are joyful. He knows that when we get bogged down in the world and look to it for our joy, that we will only become confused and our joy can be taken away. He wants us to keep that right relationship with him right there inside our hearts, so that no matter what happens on the outside, we can be joyful on the inside. I'm going to give you a little bit of an example that's not a perfect example, but how many of you have ever watched The Grinch Stole Christmas? What happened in that story? God made the Grinch stole all the things the people had. He stole their decorations and their Christmas trees and their presents and even the food off the table. And he went back up on the mountain and he was waiting for them to get up and cry. But what happened instead? They were still happy. Why were they still happy? All their decorations were gone. Because they had the spirit of Christmas in their heart, and he couldn't take that away, right? And when you have God in your heart, nobody can take that away either. So do you think God wants you to keep what you have in your heart to yourself? To yourself? No, he wants you to do what? Tell other people about it. Don't keep it all to yourself. Tell other people. When we tell others or we show others, sometimes you don't have to use your words. It can be your actions that we have God right there inside of us. Maybe they will begin to understand his great love. So joy is really knowing that we have nothing to worry about. We know that God loves us and that he sent his son, Jesus, just for us so that we might have eternal life in him, free of the things that might come to take our happiness away. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for the gift of your Son so that we might know peace and have joy in our hearts. Thank you so much for every boy and girl sitting here. Please help us to keep Jesus in our hearts so that we will never forget how much you love us, and that when we might stumble and forget, your love stands ready to remind us. Please protect and guide us and keep us safe, for it is in the name of our sweet Savior, Jesus. Amen.
good way, a good way. Thank you, children and youth and adults. Please turn to 180, the first Noel. We're going to sing all the verses because this tells a story. All the verses of 180. Let's stand together as we sing.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity to be in your house today, to study your word, to learn about you, and know about the great love that you have for us, Father. We just pray that you'll be with us today in a very special way, and we can feel your presence here with us, Father. We pray that, Father, that through this worship service today, as we celebrate the birth of your Son, Jesus Christ, who came to this world to live, to teach, and to study for us and to teach us where we can learn about the great love you have for us. And most important of all, Father, we thank you that you sent your Son to die on the cross to save us from our sins, to make it possible for all to be given and for us to live in eternity with you, Father. And when we leave this earth and come to know you, Father, in a very special way. Lord, we pray that you'll be with our pastor this morning, that you'll be with Brother Rocky as he brings the message, that we open our hearts and our minds to be receptive to what you have to say. And may we enjoy the service, may we learn from the service, and may we fellowship one with another, Father, and leave with happy hearts. Father, we pray for all our missionaries. We enjoy the program we had this morning, this week with the Adairs in Africa. And we just pray, Father, you just bless them in a very special way. And all our missionaries around the world, Father, as they go and teach your word to these people that have no other way to hear about you, Father. What a blessing that is, that people are willing to give their lives to do just that, Father. Lord, we pray for our service people this morning. We just pray that you'll bless them in a very special way, that you'll be with them through this day and through this Christmas service, and protect them as only you can, Father. And Lord, as they're away from home during the Christmas season, when this is a time for families, we just pray that you'll just help them to feel us in their hearts and know that we're there with them, Father, and all of them, and just protect them as only you can, Father. Lord, we are human. We do sin. We fall short of what you'd have us to do. We pray, Father, that you would forgive us of our sins. We pray that you would teach us from our sins, and we'd learn and we wouldn't commit the same ones over and over. Father, help us to be as much like Jesus as we can to go and serve your word through this country. Now, Father, we pray that you'll go with us through this coming week and help us to do and say the things that be pleasing with you. For it's in Christ's name that I pray. Amen.
Let's continue singing these wonderful Christmas carols. Turn to 196, O Little Town of Bethlehem, first and last verses, then 206, Silent Night, first and last verses of those. Oh! Thank y'all for that. That was beautiful. This time, please stand for the doxology, number 668. Remain standing for the offertory prayer.
Dear Heavenly Father, we ask you to bless these offerings, that they may be used to glorify your name, Lord. And we ask that you be with our servicemen and women as they can't be with their families as we celebrate the birth of our Savior, Lord. And we ask that we turn a silent night into a loud day as we proclaim your name, Lord, and shout it out. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. That's a good question that all of us need to ask. Would we miss the miracle? Have you ever missed Christmas? It's not any fun, I'll tell you. I have missed it once. We appreciate the young people letting us use their new television. Like I said, they haven't even used it yet. They sold two that were up there, two smaller ones, and got a larger one that goes on a nice wall that's been constructed up there for this purpose. And I don't know if you noticed at the bottom it says, "Get off your phones." That was worded for the young people. We have it worded a little more tactfully in our worship bulletin. Please turn them off. This kind of an idea of what we can do if we can have one of those up there and one of them up here, and then we can use we'll have a lot more available at our fingertips. If you've not taken advantage of the generous offer from Jennifer Ford and the Mary Kay products, please see her and take care of that. And every bit of that profit goes toward this particular project. So take care of that if you can. All right, Matthew chapter 2. We're going to read verses 1 through 12. Would you stand with me, please, as we honor God's word? After Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, "Where is the one who's been born King of the Jews? We saw his star in the east and have come to worship him." When King Herod heard this, he was disturbed, and all Jerusalem with him. When he had called together all the people's chief priests and teachers of the law, he asked them where the Christ was to be born. "In Bethlehem in Judea," they replied, "for this is what the prophet has written. But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For out of you will come a ruler who will be the shepherd of my people Israel." Then Herod called the Magi secretly and found out from them the exact time the star had appeared. He sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go and make a careful search for the child. As soon as you find him, report to me so that I too may go and worship him." After they had heard the king, they went on their way, and the star they had seen in the east went ahead of them until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshipped him. Then they opened their treasures and presented him with gifts of gold and of incense and of myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to go back to Herod, they returned to their country by another route. Thank you. You may be seated. Have you missed Christmas? Have you opened your eyes on the day after Christmas only to discover that the biggest day of the year had come and gone and you totally missed it? Now, people who are very sick may miss Christmas. Some have missed Christmas for many years because they've been sick for a long time. But it really did happen to me just a few years ago. Sharon and I were in Indiana, one of the last times that we were able to be up there, visiting her family for Christmas. I fell extremely ill with some kind of upper respiratory infection, the sickest I remember ever being in my life. I was out of it. And I missed Christmas Day, as well as the day after Christmas. And it was a really strange feeling to wake up 2 days later and realize you'd been out that long. But let's ask that question again. Have you ever missed Christmas? Not because you were sick. I'm talking about being so wrapped up in what Christmas has become that you miss the celebration of what Christmas was supposed to be. Perhaps you didn't miss the actual day, but you miss the point of it. We know in our heads what it's about, but occasionally we fail to keep Christmas. We do the buying and shopping and visiting and eating and partying, and
But somehow we miss it. And we're not the first. There were several people who missed that first Christmas. They missed it for various reasons. King Herod missed it. Herod was not a descendant of David, and you may remember that he was not even a full-blooded Jew. He had been appointed king by the Romans, the occupying Romans, but the Jewish people did not accept him as the true king of Israel. They never did. So when the Magi showed up saying that they had traveled a great distance in order to worship the one born to be king of the Jews, it frightened Herod. He panicked. He was deeply agitated, and because Herod was agitated, so was everyone else in Jerusalem. Herod missed it because he was afraid he might lose his power. There are still people today who see Jesus as a threat, and they oppose the very idea of Christmas. For several years, the little town of Knightstown, Indiana, has had a Christmas tree, and instead of a star at the top of it, they've had a cross. It's been there all along. But this year, one person complained. And the Indiana ACLU had filed a lawsuit against the town. The man said that he is being forced to have unwelcome contact with the cross. It's sad if it wasn't kind of a little bit funny too. He says it has caused him irreparable harm. I wonder what kind of harm he experiences when he drives down the street and sees crosses on tops of churches. When he sees a cross on around a lady's neck on a necklace. When he just sees the shape that a telephone pole makes. When he sees sometimes in doors, you can see the shape of a cross as the cross is there in the door. But that is one sad individual who's going to miss Christmas. Many people miss Christmas today because of their own fears, which is kind of tragic considering that one of the most important elements of this story is the one given by the angels, which is, fear not. Herod never heard that message, and he missed Christmas. But regardless of the reasons, if fear is gripping your heart this Christmas, you need to hear the angels say, fear not. There's no mention of an innkeeper, but we assume there was one. We don't really know if they even talked to an innkeeper. You remember that scene that we, you know, in our minds of Mary and Joseph at the door and the innkeeper's pointing, you know, get away from here, I don't have any room. You remember that scene? That's not in the Bible. They may not have even talked to the innkeeper. Joseph may have merely heard around the watering hole that was no use even asking because they were full. Maybe someone else had been turned away. We don't know. The innkeeper, though, missed it because he was preoccupied and busy. We can't really blame him. Caesar Augustus had issued a decree that everyone should be taxed. And so he took the census to make sure they knew how many people there were, to make sure everybody paid his or her fair share of taxes. So no matter where you were currently living, you had to make the trip back to the town of your ancestors. Some Bible scholars estimate the population of Bethlehem to have been right around 1,000, or maybe a little bit less, during the census taking, kind of about the size of Utica. But during the census taking, that number would certainly have swelled to many times that number. Since Bethlehem was so small, perhaps there was only one inn there. The innkeeper may not have been hostile or uncaring toward the couple, but he was just busy. While probably grateful for the extra business, he had his hands full. And he missed Christmas. We might miss Christmas simply because we're just preoccupied with the business of life. The religious people missed it. After the Magi told Herod why they were there, Herod called together all the chief priests and Pharisees, and the scripture does say he called all of them together. He wanted to know from the scriptures where the Christ, the Messiah, was to be born. He knew where to look. He knew who to ask. He knew where the answer was. They knew the answer. All those chief priests and Pharisees, they knew the answer because they had studied the Scripture. So they told Herod that the Messiah was going to be born in the tiny, insignificant town of Bethlehem, only 6 miles from Herod's palace. But the religious leaders did not make the slightest effort to go see for themselves. They missed it because their religion got in the way. They missed it because they were indifferent. Everywhere we look, we can still see people who are unresponsive and uninterested in the real story of Jesus. They may not oppose him, they just ignore him. They just ignore his role in the Christmas story. And then finally, the people in the town of Bethlehem may have known the scriptures that the religious scholars had shared with Herod. Can you imagine a certain sort of town pride? We're the town that the scripture says the Messiah is going to be born. Certainly they all knew what was going to happen. But it had been hundreds and hundreds of years since that prophecy had been made. In fact, the very first mention of a coming Messiah is found in the scriptures while Adam and Eve are still in the garden. Why should this night be any different, though? Bethlehem missed it because they weren't expecting it. Our problem is not that. We have a different problem. We know Christmas is coming. We even have a date on the calendar for it. But it's come and gone so many times that we no longer pay attention to the essence of it. We miss the wonder of it because we are too familiar with it. Philip Yancey, in a book he entitled "The Jesus I Never Knew," he said this: "The facts of Christmas, rhymed in carols, recited by children in church plays, illustrated on cards, have become so familiar that it is easy to miss the message behind the facts." So how do we keep from missing the message? How do we assure ourselves that on the day after Christmas, we won't look back with regret because we were so busy that the celebration of the world's most important event skipped right past us without our noticing? Now, there were some in the Christmas story who didn't miss it. The shepherds, Anna and Simeon in the temple 8 days later. Of course, Joseph and Mary, they didn't miss it. But today I want to focus on the Magi. I want to suggest that we can make sure we do not miss Christmas by doing the same things they did. What did they do? Well, let's look at it. Verses 1 and 2. Let's immerse ourselves in the story. That's the first thing. Let's immerse ourselves in the story. These wise men came a great distance to see this child, and they were probably accompanied by an entourage of attendants. I mean, if I were traveling through the desert and the wilderness like that with expensive gifts like they had, I would probably have a few bodyguards with me. We do not know that there were only three. We do not know they were kings, and we do not know exactly where they came from. All the scripture says is that they came from the east. There is an ancient legend about them that says there were three of them. And even the legend even gives us their names, Melchior, Balthazar, and Gaspar, from three different nations, Babylonia, Persia, and India. Now, they may have even been Jews who had been scattered. There were Jews living all over the known world by this time. And these Jews had studied the scripture. Persia, at this time, had a highly developed system of astronomy, not astrology. There's a difference. Numbers 24:17 would have told them, a star, this is what it says, a star shall come out of Jacob, a scepter shall rise out of Israel. The star tells them that's going to be the sign. The scepter in that verse told them it would be a king. So when they saw the star, they were familiar with its with the significance of it, and they were curious enough about it to follow. Several times, just want to answer this question that might be lingering. Several times in this story, we learn that angels appeared to various individuals and told them what to do next. And I believe it's possible that the Magi may have received at least some of their information from an angelic messenger as well. But think about this. These men, whoever they were, however many there were, put their entire lives on hold to come see the Christ child. This wasn't their job. The methods of travel were primitive. It surely took several weeks and maybe even months if one came from India. May have taken several months for them to make this trip, but they were totally immersed in the goal of seeing the child for themselves. In the first part of verse 11, we read, "On coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary." Now look at that little word, saw, S-A-W. They saw the child. The original word means to find after searching. To find after searching, indicating that these men were immersing themselves in the task of finding the child. There was some work involved in this. Some effort involved. They were fully engaged in it. In the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus said, "Seek and you will find." And the word he used for seek is the same word that we see here in verse 11. Seek, it's an effort you have to make. They had sought him because they were involved. Now, if we want to make sure we do not miss Christmas, we need to once again find some fascination with this story. We need to become captivated with the idea that Holy God loved us enough to come here and become one of us so that he could die for us to provide a way for us to go to heaven, to spend eternity with him forever. We should allow ourselves to be absorbed in the sights and the sounds of that first Christmas, allowing our imaginations to take us all the way back to that very first night. We should be engaged in every Christmas carol, in every experience, every moment that makes up this special season, realizing that like the Magi, we will find him when we seek him. The second thing the Magi did that we need to do, let's celebrate the birth of Christ. Let's celebrate his birth. Verse 10 reads, "When they saw the star, they were overjoyed." By the way, the word saw in verse 10 is not the same one as verse 11. Same English word, but two different Greek words. Okay? This word just simply means to see. They saw the star. They saw it. Because they've been following it all along. They didn't have to look for it. But look what happened when they saw the star. The New International Version says that they were overjoyed. But I'm just not sure that's enough. So let's pick up our old King James Bibles and let's read what it says in verse 10. It says, "When they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceeding great joy." Words piled on top of each other to help us understand this was a big deal. When we break down the original language, we find something very interesting. It says literally that they rejoiced with exceedingly mega joy. In fact, the original Greek word is actually the word mega. Mega. I can't imagine these Magi seeing the star and realizing that their journey was about to end and knowing that they were about to see the child and saying to each other, "Well, it's kind of late. Aren't you tired? I'm a little bit hungry. Was that a drop of rain I felt? Perhaps we should wait till tomorrow." They've probably already said it, put him down for the night. But listen, this was not, when it says they rejoiced with exceedingly great joy, this was not a ho-hum experience for them. That I believe they were excited. That's what it says. Can you imagine them slapping each other on the backs, maybe making some noise, perhaps shouting, even cheering with anticipation of what was about to happen? In our day, it's unfortunate that we call much of what we do at Christmas celebrating. It is regrettable that the highest expression of Christmas celebration that many people know is found in a bottle or else on a plate piled high with empty calories. It is tragic that for many people, spending time at parties with people we don't know or don't like is the extent of what they call celebrating. Shouldn't it mean more than that? Shouldn't there be more to it than that? If we want to make sure we do not miss Christmas, we should confirm that our celebration of the birth of our Savior is a true celebration, that it's filled with the emotion and the joy and the wonder that His coming deserves. If we immerse ourselves in the story the way the Magi did, we will not be able to merely move through the calendar without some rediscovery of the holiness of the season. When we say celebrate, we're not necessarily talking about traditions that we have here in our country or that other cultures have. We Christians should not be ashamed to say that we are celebrating the birth of our Lord and Savior. And we should not allow anyone to intimidate us into remaining silent. I want to say to that man in Knightstown, Indiana, you just need to get over it. That cross has been there a long time. There have been crosses around in this world a long time. But we, like the Magi, should rejoice with exceedingly mega joy, even if we make some noise in the meantime. Number three. This is the middle part of verse 11. We should worship the one who was born. The middle of verse 11 tells us that what the Magi did when they came to the house, into the house. It says they bowed down and worshiped Him. Now, what I imagine to have been boisterous celebration outside turned into quiet reverence as they finally see the Christ child born to be King of the Jews. But looking at the words gives us a little better understanding of what happened. The words bowed down literally means that these men fell down. They fell down in front of Mary and the child Jesus. And that word translated worshiped, it means to kiss the hand, especially as an act of reverence. But there's another meaning to that word that gives us a visual picture of the scene. People from the east, which is where these men were from, people from the east, in showing deep reverence to someone, would not only fall to their knees, but they would bend over with their faces to the ground, touching their forehead to the ground if they could do that. This was not an ordinary baby they were looking for, you see. And when they found Him, they treated Him with the reverence and the awe that He deserved. We are celebrating the birth of the same Lord as they. Only we had the advantage of knowing so much more about Him than they did. They knew He had been born to be King of the Jews. But we know He is the God-man who stepped out of heaven to become a human being. We know about His miracles. We have His teachings. We know He died in our place on the cross, and we know He rose victoriously from death. They did not have that knowledge. The one whose birth we celebrate is not ordinary. If we want to make sure we do not miss Christmas, we should make sure that our observance of His birth includes some personal worship time. Now, I'm not just talking about being in church next Sunday morning, though I certainly want to encourage you to do that. But mostly we should find some time to kneel before Him as part of our Christmas and worship Him. If you're struggling with what to do next Christmas, next Sunday morning, I want to remind you it was the Lord's Day a long time before it was Christmas Day. Number four, the third part of verse 11, the last part of it. Number four, we should give to the causes of the one who was born. After the Magi fell to their knees and they bent over with their faces to the ground, they opened their treasures. And by the way, that Greek word is thesaurus. You know what a thesaurus is. They opened their treasures. They brought these gifts with them across all the miles. And you know the story. It says they presented to him gifts of gold and of frankincense and myrrh. These valuable items were standard gifts to honor a king in the ancient world. Gold is a precious metal. Frankincense is a perfume. Myrrh is an anointing oil. There may have been more gifts than that, but those are the only ones that Matthew tells us about. And because he only mentions three gifts, that's probably what led to the idea that there were only three of these men. Those gifts may have been symbolic in ways the Magi didn't fully understand, but they were certainly costly. We don't know how much gold and how much frankincense and how much myrrh they brought to him, so we don't really know how much. We have no way of knowing how much their gifts were worth. We can only take educated guesses. We do know they didn't pick those gifts up at the local department store on the way into town. They probably obtained the gold through trade, and it was probably not in the form of coins. The incense comes from a frankincense tree that has to be at least 8 to 10 years old before they can harvest it. The resin is collected by hand. Myrrh is also a resin, and at times in history it was so valuable that it cost as much as gold. So these gifts were rare and expensive, which may have led to the idea that these men were kings. But we don't know how much they gave. Let's say that they gave only an ounce of each. In today's currency, an ounce of gold is worth around $1,100. It changes every day. But right now it's worth around $1,100 for an ounce of gold. Some Bible scholars estimate that at that time, translated into modern money, frankincense would have cost about $500 a pound. Myrrh would have cost $4,000 a pound. Now, so we can know that these gifts were costly, and we can assume that the wise men spent a great deal of money to obtain them. But never one time did the Magi look around them, once they get inside the house, look around them at the simplicity of the home of the Holy Family and question whether or not they should have brought such expensive items. The instant they walked into that little house, they were carrying in their hands the most expensive things in that house. And it may have even been those gifts which helped finance the Holy Family's flight to Egypt. If we want to make sure we do not miss Christmas, we should give to kingdom causes. Now, don't misunderstand me. I'm not saying that we are not truly observing Christmas unless we give a lot of money to the church. I'm not saying that. Christmas is certainly a time for giving, as we know very well. But what I am saying is that those gifts presented to the Christ child were appropriate for the wise men to give because they obviously could afford them. The question each of us must ask is, am I giving to soothe my conscience, or am I giving what is appropriate for me to give? We should make sure that on our gift list we include gifts for the causes of the kingdom of God. That certainly should include year-end giving to your church, but it includes mission offerings. It includes other charitable giving. Do it in the name of the one whose birth we celebrate. And then there's one more I want to share with you. In verse 12, to make sure we don't miss Christmas, let's obey the commands he gives. Verse 12, and having been warned in a dream not to go back to Herod, they returned to their country by another route. Herod had asked them, remember, to come back to him and tell him where the child was so he could go and worship him as well. And as far as they knew, that was the truth. They didn't know what Herod was planning to do. They did not know the evil in this man's heart. Given his history of killing whoever was suspected of opposing him, he might have killed the wise men too. So the Magi are warned in a dream not to go back the same way. They obeyed. Now, this may be something we've never thought about much this time of year. In fact, you may hear this next year too. Obedience is one of the hallmarks of the Christmas story. Zechariah and Elizabeth obeyed, and the one who later was known as John the Baptist was born. Mary obeyed, and her reply to the angel had been, "I am the Lord's servant, may it be to me as you have said. Joseph obeyed. And we read in Matthew 1:24, when Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him. The shepherds obeyed. And we hear them saying, "Let us go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." Both Anna and Simeon were obedient. And they were in the temple the day Joseph and Mary brought Jesus into the temple to be circumcised. The Magi were obedient. And their obedience may have saved their lives. It certainly delayed Herod's search for the child by maybe a couple of days. If we want to make sure we do not miss Christmas, we need to be careful to obey Him. It is an essential part of living the Christ life, folks. I cannot be said to be a follower of Christ as long as I am disobedient. The stance of the Christ follower should be, "He says so, therefore I will do it." That should be the only question there is. We're not just talking about obedience around Christmas time. This is not like staying off of Santa's naughty list. This is love and obedience that comes from a heart that is truly and totally devoted to Him as Lord and Master. December 25th will come and go, and I don't want to miss it. Do you? Then let's immerse ourselves in the story. Let's find fascination once again in the wonder of what it means. Let's make sure we celebrate the birth of the one who came to die for us. Let's kneel before Him in worship. Let's include gifts to the causes of the kingdom of God along with all the other gifts that we give to others. Make sure that that's on your list. And let's make sure that we are obedient throughout the year. Have you missed Christmas before? You have a week. Don't miss it this year. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we come to You now to thank You, Father, for loving us and for sending Your Son Jesus for us. We celebrate His birth. We pray, Father, You'll help us to celebrate it no matter where we go this year, no matter what we're doing. You'll help us to be bright and shining witnesses, Lord, no matter where we are. Father, in just a moment, we're going to have an opportunity to respond to the message that God might have given to each of us. And I pray, Father, You'll give us the courage to step out and say, "Yeah, this is me. This is where I am. And I want to make sure I don't miss it this year." I pray, Lord, You'll help us to make that commitment. Help us see how important it is. Help us to follow You the way the wise men followed the star. Now, folks, the last thing I want to do is to come up here, prepare this message. I've been working on it for weeks. To come up here this morning and preach this message, and for you to say, "Oh, yeah, that's right. I need to do that." And walk out of here without anything being different, without anything changing. The last thing I want to do. And don't you want to make sure that your time that you've spent here this morning counted for something? Are you closer to Him now than you were when you walked in those doors? The choir very beautifully sang, "No one can bring My praises but Me." Well, you know, there's no one who can do anything about your relationship with the Lord except you. The best time to start is right now. Will you come as we stand? Thank you so much for being here. We've had some good worship opportunities during this Christmas season, and I hope you'll be here tonight. This is the little preview we got this morning reminds us of how special this season is, and we look forward to tonight. And then next Sunday, our Christmas service at 9:30. Listen, the message I'm working on for next Sunday is something I've uncovered in recent months, and I want to share this with you. This may be the most important word that we can use in celebrating Christmas. I hope you'll be here next Sunday to hear it. Now it's time for our blessing. Raise one hand for yourself and one hand for someone else. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn His face toward you and give you peace. Amen. Love you. See you tonight.